Okay, I'm going to get started right now with the presentation. So the first person that we are going to ask is Nicole. Nicole is a teacher at Maryvale Middle School and a very active WNYnet member. She comes to a lot of our events. I always look forward to talking to her about things. Nicole's been able to analyze a lot of the modules, which I know we talk a lot about on the Facebook page, and she has a lot of insight about those, and I'm sure she's got a great presentation to share with you now. So.
Okay, so modules, it's not exactly the way to come into this group, right? And my topic may not be sexy, but it's definitely like practical, and I think that you'll find that it's useful. Depending on which district you're in, I've talked to a number of the different administrators at area districts, and a lot of different teachers over the last couple years, and we have some districts that have come whole hog saying that you need to do every module, you know, and here's like 1,200 pages, right? Staple them, copy them, pass them out. And then we have other districts that have said we need to adapt them, but no one knows exactly what that means, or they're trying to learn what that means. I'm just going to share some experience. I've also gone to Teachers College in New York for the last 2 years. I'm going for a third time this month. And so talking about how to maybe bring in some of those materials as well, and not be afraid of them, or not be very often. Okay, so one thing is these are materials that come from Teachers College, and one thing that comes across if you're Caucus and you think like, oh, I don't have a workshop classroom, I don't want a workshop classroom, I don't want canned materials, it's scripted, you know, all of these things that come to it, but the district also, districts like and know the language. Even the format is like now similar to like the format of the modules, and everything's like coming together in some intergalactic cloud. And this can be really helpful to you as well. These are from the units of study specifically for teaching writing. And I just wanted to point out, I've been using Caucus, well, pieces of Caucus for years. And this new material that they come out with, put together in these units of study, has a great array of anchor charts that they've already made, like things that we've always said, like, oh, I would love to teach that, but really, do I have time to do a flip chart and to like write all this out? And what I'm finding as I'm going through these materials and starting to share them with my colleagues is that it's bringing us closer together when we're using our own curriculum. So we're able to, you know, I'm doing an argument unit. I haven't changed what I want to do. I still have in my head what I want to do for my argument unit, but then as I'm going through, I'm finding that, you know, two or three of us are using the same charts for our argument unit. We may end up like having different products and different texts and different, but we can tell our district that we are adapting a unit from Caucus, it's Common Core Line, and that we're using and mining these materials from them, and it is bringing us together. And so it's just, I brought the resources with me if anyone is not using them and would like to go through them and see how they can be repurposed or used. I'd be happy to share those with you. Another thing is, I've been teaching at Maryvale for 15 years. I did 8th grade for 12 years, so my first year of teaching was the first year of the state assessment, so I've been living it my whole life, and I've been living, you know, the data in your face, right, dictating everything you do. I've been doing 7th grade for the last 3 years, and in that time, I would say probably about 8 years ago, Angela Stockman, like, just taught me how to use data and use the research and use the language to get a district to do what you want, you know, like to find your creative freedom. And that's kind of the push behind all of this. So one of these is setting up collaborative partnerships, you know, so we're all here. And by setting up partnerships with my colleagues at Maryvale, we set up a Dropbox together. I'm sure a lot of people are doing this, but a shared Dropbox, it has, you know, 4,000 plus files on it. We like organize it. We're able to plan, beg, borrow, and steal in real time without having to be in a room together. And it's amazing how your revision can ramp up from what would take 1 to 3 years to taking, you know, you could do that in 1 year just by seeing what someone did last night and how they changed something, what they're using in their classroom as a result of what they taught the day before. And to see a video clip that someone took of student work or a picture and put it on there. And it's what you're actually doing right then. So I would highly suggest you like OneDrive or Dropbox. And it can go beyond. Oh yeah, this is another one. It's great for you know, collecting your video clips and sharing them. It's like in anything that you're using or any of your ideas, they don't just have to be your lesson plans. And we started linking them like directly to our learning targets so that when we're looking for something, we can find it. This is a way of storing and sharing all of that stuff so you're not constantly going onto the web. But you can also do this beyond district lines. So last year I did a 5-day workshop with Expeditionary Learning at Cleve Hill. And I was in a room, it was great, for 5 days spread out throughout the course of the year. I was in a room with about the same 20 people, but they were from like 8 different districts. And so we were able to talk about the same materials and what we had been doing. And I ended up partnering with teachers from Cleve Hill and on a module. And they were told that they had to do all of them. And I was told that I needed to adapt one. So I took something that they had already done, right? And I asked them, like, what was your experience with it? What are the pros and cons? And what did you make? They ended up sharing all of the materials that they made with me and their experience. So then I brought it back to my district. And my colleague and I, like, this is our module. Like, these are like snapshots, right, from like throughout our module. And it was like all in an interactive presentation. And it took 13 days. And it was dynamic and it was engaging and it was awesome. And it brought my kids to like movement. And it was a module. And so they don't have to be what the districts show you or what the state shows you. And if you are in a position that you have to do something, I would highly suggest partnering with the district and then also suggest making it your own and being forceful and like sharing it with the district that you are doing this. This is just how you're doing it. And then they were really happy to get it back. You know, like, so then I sent this like immediately back to the teachers that shared with me. And they went through and they were like, you know, incredibly appreciative. But then we shared it with, you know, someone over at BOCES, because like open source collaboration, it's like one of the positives, right, in this age. And so then going a little further into some of the materials that we have available to us, on if your district is talking about modules and you do want to like work that and they're asking like 21st century skills and Common Core alignment and all these things, you know, you don't have to do everything. So like if you go back to Appendix A and you look at those protocols, and I don't know how many people are familiar with or use the protocols from EL. Okay. So you don't have to use, and there are only a couple of you, and if there aren't, it's a way of adapting the modules without adapting the modules, right? You can adapt like protocols that really do, depending on how you use them, and depending on which ones you use, they can really ramp up the engagement in your class. They can flip your class into a 21st century environment of collaboration. And so they are available on Engage New York. And it's a way of like being able to keep your units of study and keep what you want to teach while adapting to the modules. And so this is just an example of how I took something that I've always done, be the protagonist. I've always put my kids in the protagonist perspective in their writing. I've always had them come up with questions. But then I decided to use a protocol to bring them through that. So I would have like my learning targets and whatever protocol I have, I've got like directions for the kids to go through with me. And sometimes on Vimeo, there will even be videos that you can like watch a quick 2-minute video, 30-second video with your students even to show them what the protocol looks like before they do it, to show them how to get up and act, to show them how to like stand up and line up and where to go. And I will then take a video of like my first class doing it, so then I can use that with my second class. So this is like be the protagonist on the hot seat, and I can show this later if anyone wants to come. I have like a number of different videos of the different ones, and then you know my rubric for it, and then debriefing. But this little cycle, right, of like being able to get the kids up and engaged using different protocols at your hand, is a way of doing what we've been asked to do in a non-threatening way that you get to decide how you do it and what you do it with. Another way is using APPR. I mean, APPR sucks, right? But like, we can find power from it. A number of years ago, I was in, I spent, like 8 days of my life doing a school need improvement report with the state, and the binder was like this big, and you know, all the evidence and all the plans and everything. And working through that process, I did once again learn how to like use the data and use their system against them. You know, and in like a way to like empower myself and also get what we need for kids. And it was amazing because it was in the report that a good idea would be to have an 80-minute block so you could have workshop, and it would be a good idea to be trained at Teachers College, and it would be a good idea to do these things. And then we put it in the report to the state. The district then did fund it. You know, and so as a result of that, I'm still going to Teachers College, and I still have an 80-minute block that's not mandated. And so I think another way of doing this is with APPR goal setting. You know, we've got goals that we are mandated to set every year. And so if we start to use these goals for making real change, you know, instead of, if they tell you you have to choose one of these three things, well, fine, choose one of those three things, but then figure out how you can do it. So my district right now is doing a ton of, like, let's send you to BOCES for performance-based assessment. Let's do this. You know, here's a book on performance-based assessment. Well, a colleague and I, we decided, let's write our goal. We don't want another final exam. These kids are tested enough. So let's get rid of our final. And let's have a performance-based assessment using the research and using the goal setting. But it's in the district language. It's in the district website. It's in their system. And so we're going to get a research project instead of our final. You know, you can make change by using their language and their systems. There are a couple things that I could share later on as well about, like, there are tuning protocols. I don't know, does anyone know the tuning protocol through EL? So it's like, it's something that Expeditionary Learning actually like put out to help us do our own thing with the modules. You know, but the state doesn't give it to us, but it's there. And if we use it, it's put out there by EL, it's put out there, and we can actually like go to a district administrator, go to a department head and say, this is what I'm doing, this is how I changed it from this, and this is why. And this is the protocol I use to do so.
Is that on Engage New York, or is
it's
that
on EL?
It's on EL. It's okay. They hide it, and the only way, like, it's crazy. I didn't get it until I was like meeting with like the director of EL, and then she starts talking about like how we can do this and what you can do, and it's just amazing. It's like we're definitely not as. And then I had the administrator from director of curriculum from Lancaster say like, wow, that would be so much better to like presented that way to my teachers. I'm not kidding. You know, but like they just screwed up in the beginning. But there are ways that we can fix it. And then this is the adapting module as well to how to change it. But I think the tuning protocol is very helpful for doing your own thing. And so these are just like the possibilities. Like we could, in a breakout session, we could like set up collaborative partnerships with possible like unit or module ideas even to just spiral back and forth between. We could explore materials or resources from the pockets units of study to just material mine, repurpose, you know. I brought even a couple laptops to like see all those. And then check out like the classroom protocols to infuse interactivity from the modules into your own units. That's a way of saying it, you're adapting the modules. And then using the tuning protocols and language to format your existing. And it's like a little toolkit to survival and creativity. Because honestly, I felt really stuck probably like 6 years ago. Like I didn't know if I was gonna stick with this. And I took a year and a half off, and I just like went back to like what education for education sake. And when I came back in, I decided like I couldn't just be angry. I needed to figure out like a way to harness my creativity and empower myself, and these things have all helped. And I've got to say, like, I feel better than I could possibly imagine about teaching. And that's like when you're surrounded by so many people feeling not that way. So I would just like to kind of help. So thank you.
So what we're going to talk about today is how building strong relationships builds stronger children. And the first thing I want to start with is I want to start with an essential question that will kind of drive this conversation. What is our job as educators? Now, when we all got in the game, I'm sure we all had our personal desires. We had a teacher that really made an impact on our lives. We had a set of adults who moved us, who motivated us, who pushed us, so to speak. And that's probably a main reason why we got in the game. All right? But here in 2015, there's this pushback now. There's the rigorous demands of the Common Core, all right? And so, as we talk today, I will challenge you to think about, first, what our job is as educators and how this kind of pendulum is swinging between our personal desires and the rigorous demands of the Common Core, because, of course, there has to be that balance, right? So, the first thing I want to start off with is my educational mantra. I'm sure you all have one, but this is your personal mission or what have you. For my undergrad, or for the undergrad or graduate students in here, once you walk into an interview, this is almost always a question. Like, why did you become a teacher? What is your stand as a teacher, right? And so mine is, you know, I think our job is to ensure that every child, not some, not the highs, not the cusp kids, but that every child is prepared to become a fully functioning, active, and participating member of society. All right? That doesn't just mean that they need to know how to add 1 + 2. That doesn't mean that they need to just know how to read an article and answer questions about it. They need to know how to take that information, those skills, those strategies, and apply them to real life concrete situations. Situations that they will approach in their lives. Right? So, you know, when I was talking to a bunch of undergrads, like, this is something that really hit home for them. If this is something that you don't have, like this mindset, right? This mission, this personal mission, I would urge you to adopt one sooner rather than later, because with these changes that are coming on, I mean, how many of us have heard about this whole Cuomo thing, right? This whole Cuomo thing, this war against teachers, right? Family, friends, they're going to ask you, what's your stand? And I'm prepared to answer that question. Hey, listen. You know, whether my APPR score says that I'm ineffective, right? Or I'm developing and I'm no longer qualified to be a teacher according to those standards. You know what? This is still my mission. And I will find one way to make that happen, right? Whether it's in the classroom or pursuing other means. So really what I want to talk about is, how do you communicate that passion? How do you communicate that mantra, that mission to your students? Here's my buddy, Mr. Joe Clark. Can you lean on me?
Right. If you're a teacher, you haven't seen it, check it out. Right? check it out. All right, it's a good movie. But hey, Joe Clark, he'll stand up on a soapbox with his megaphone and call students out. Right? But you know, sometimes that's what they need. That tough love.
But how are you communicating as a teacher, as a professional, as an individual, that hey, to your students, I care about you. Right? I want to know more about you. Right? I care about your success inside and outside of the classroom. So many times our students think that we're just focused on their achievement on one of these tests that we give them, right? One of these tests. And what their level is, whether they're benchmark, strategic, or intensive, right? And so how are you communicating ways that you desire this personal relationship with your students? And that takes me to my next question. Well, actually, first, let me tell you, upon research, students were surveyed, and there were criteria that students appreciated, desired, and asked for in teachers, all right? So, going the wrong way. By the way, this is like my second Prezi. I'm really excited. I used to be real old school. Like, when I learned how to do PowerPoint, I got excited. I mastered PowerPoint, got all the animations and everything there. I did one of these talks in Shannon's class not too long ago. Kids are like, hey, have you heard of Prezi? And that made me feel old, so I had to go back to school and learn how to do it, okay? So, what students say from a... the research has been done, but I actually pulled this chart from this book, The Skillful Teacher. It's a professional development that Buffalo's sending a bunch of their teachers through. But this flow chart represents some data that was collected from students. And I go ahead and I put it up here as a hashtag, right? Hashtag good teachers. Students say that the teachers that they love and respect acknowledge them, right? They acknowledge them as individuals, right? And they value them. They respect them, right? And now, we all know about respecting students. That's calling the student out, you know, hey,
What you doing back there? Pick your head up, wake up, right? Okay, or just, hey, we're walking by with a kick on the chair or something like that, right? Respect them, right? Students or teachers are fair, right? Not nitpicky. They also appreciate and respect teachers that are real, right? And teachers who are open to humor and fun. So we'll kind of unpack each of these a little bit as we go along, and more so in the breakout sessions, because if you know me, I like to talk, and I could do a whole 90-minute lecture on this. I only have 5 minutes. Thank you very much. All right, thank you. This is why we work well together. So let me ask you one more question, right? I'm going to challenge you to self-assess, all right? Make it personal. Self-assess. Are you the type of teachers who's in it for the paycheck, right? Are you the type of teacher? Listen. So, and the reason why I ask this question, and I don't apologize if I'm ruffling feathers or making you uncomfortable, because the reality is, ladies and gentlemen, we work with disenfranchised teachers who have been in the game for so long that this is where they are, right? They want to collect their paycheck, right? They want to get out for their summers, right? And that's what it is, all right? That's what drives them. Or are you the type of teacher who's in it for every child, where it's your passion? So is it your job or is it your passion? And that's my challenge to you. That's a question that I want you to think about. So when we talk about acknowledging and valuing your students, I would say get to know your students. So as ELA teachers, one way, we want students to be readers, right? We want students to be lifelong readers and writers. So here's a reading interest survey I gave to a bunch of my students, because if you ask my students, an overwhelming number of them will say, I hate reading. Oh, reading is stupid, it's boring. Right? And I tell them, well, listen, if you hate reading, you're doing it wrong. But just asking students what their favorite genres are, right? And then using this to drive and build your classroom library, right? To pick those tests that you're going to use for your entire class. And then one of my favorite questions on this survey was, what do you think you're best at as a reader? And this student right here says, I know it's a bad copy, but this student says reading. This student tells Mr. Lewis, it takes me forever to read a book, because I'll read something and I'll ask myself, like, what was that about? Or my mom will ask me and I can't answer. So I go back and I reread it. And of course, we all know it's monitoring, right? Monitoring for sense. So now, as a teacher, I know one of my lessons, one of my units needs to be on, you know, hey, maybe your peers may not have that skill, right? Maybe you could do an even better job of refining that skill. So I'm basing it right off of what students are telling me. You'll be surprised. When I gave the survey, a lot of students just didn't know what each of these genres were, right? There's students sitting in our classrooms right now who have never read a novel, right? If you don't believe it, ask them, right? Another thing, we want our students to be not just readers, but we want them to be writers. We want to know about our students, so why not get to know about them through writing? This is an idea I pulled from, it's a book written by George L. L. Lyon, called Where I'm From. And what it does is it takes this poem, you use this poem with the beginning of I'm From, and you kind of incorporate sensory language to tell a little bit about yourself, right? A little bit about your background. So this is me, and this is a poem I would share with the students, telling them all about me, all right? Some of my favorite lines, right? I'm from the year of the thriller, when cartoons and cereal were the morning norm, and music was original, tasteful, and you couldn't stop till you got enough, right? I'm from my grandfather's house, where I learned to fish, appreciate the game of baseball, and love wrestling. Passions I've passed down to my children, all right? And this creates commonality between you and your children. Oh, Mr. Lewis, you like wrestling? Oh, who you like, The Rock or John Cena? let's reel it in. We'll talk about that another time, all right? But you may think that this is an assignment you can give at the beginning of the year as an icebreaker. But think about how we can use this as ELA teachers, right? Pick your protagonist of your text. write an item from poem written from that protagonist's point of view. What would a protagonist say they're from? What would a protagonist say life was like growing up for them? Right? What are the smells the protagonist would state? Do it for the antagonist. All right? I'm in the zone. Okay? All right, we could talk more about that in the breakout session. All right, respect your students and be real. One thing my students will tell you is that my family is very important to me. My family comes into the classroom, all right? They're in and out all the time. My students know my kids, right? Because I use them in my classroom, right? So let students in and show them that choices matter. Here, this is my writer's notebook right here, right? And one strategy that I use when I'm introducing the writer's notebook is setting up our writing territories, right? It's one of the first things we do in our writer's notebook, and here you go, this is Mr. Lewis's writer's notebook. You'll notice the room numbers cross out because I've been bounced around so many times. If you teach in Buffalo, you know what that's like, right? So here are my writing territories. And what I do, I just teach you, take something that's important to you. Bring in pictures, all right? Bring in magazine articles, clippings, things like that, of items that are important to you. These are the territories that you can always go to when you're stumped for an idea of writing. So here's my family right here. Just thinking, just kind of like a brain vomit, right? Let those ideas pour out on the page. And if I'm ever stuck, Mr. Lewis, I'm done writing. I don't have anything to write about. Okay, I'm done. Okay, go back to your writing territories. Pick a topic. No, go ahead. Stretch that idea down the page. All right? And, of course, all I'm doing right here, ladies and gentlemen, is modeling. Okay? It's just modeling. But opening up to students, right, it helps build that relationship with them. Okay, well, hey, what is this teacher doing? Being real, all right? So there's no fakeness there. Teaching students how to choose books, all right? I know growing up, one of my least favorite things was the fact that teachers shoved certain books down my throat, right? No, I don't want to read Catch Me in the Rye. Count of Monte Cristo? Man, this thing's like this big! And the font is so tiny. I don't want to read that, right? But, you know, if you're from the School of Teachers College, right, you know, choice is important. Same thing with writing topics, right? So, you know, give students tools and resources for choosing just right books, right? Let them know that their input, their choice, their opinions are valued in your classrooms, right? I tell them right there, this is one of the most important things, right? Can I relate? Is this something I can relate to, right? Is this something like I could take with me? Am I going to pull anything out of the theme of this story and move forward with it? All right? Hey, listen, that's why Diary of a Wimpy Kid is one of the most popular books in my classroom. I had four copies of the entire series at the beginning of the year. I think I'm down to about 10 total. And if you don't know, I think there are 9 volumes in the book, including the movie diary, right? Because the kids, they eat it up. They can relate to Greg Heffley, all right? They can relate to Patty Farrell and Roger and Rowley, all right? So let them know that their opinions and their interests are value. Last thing, have fun and be humorous. Now, Shannon can attest to this. If there's one thing that we do in my classrooms, we have fun, right? We have fun. But we also celebrate greatness, right? So up top, you'll see writing celebrations. These students go through this writing process, and I'll tell you, some of my students said, hey, Mr. Lewis, this is the first time we ever went through the entire writing process. Like, you know, like the teacher will give us a paper and say, hey, it's time to write, and then, you know, it'll be due on Friday. That's it. Well, you know, pick apart the process, right? Layer it, scaffold it, and I guarantee you, your product will be that much better. And so what we did is we, you know, every time we write, we celebrate. We did a gallery walk right here, and I always bring the kids in, like, sparkling grape juice, and we toast to the writing process. Because you know what? Hey, the students were extremely proud. They were very, very proud of their work.
We even had some kind of like a poetry slam type thing. These were our narratives where students came up, like students voted, hey, what were some of your favorite stories? And the students actually verbally gave effective feedback. You know, I really like Malachi's story because it talks about how he changed from, you know, being afraid to being the strong role model. Oh, really? Malachi, would you like to read your story? And then boom, all right? This is now Malachi's class, Malachi's presents. What else are we practicing? Public speaking, right? Star students, we always highlight and recognize our students, whether it's for uniform, whether it's for grades, all right? Post those pics up and give them something to be proud of. Give them a reason to want to walk in the building. Remember why they're here. Like Jim was saying, so much of their childhood is being taken from them through this testing, right? Let's give it back to them. That's our job. And by the way, you'll notice that everything that I'm doing is still related to, it's all grounded in Common Core standards. I'm just putting my own twist on it, all right? Hey, make them smile. There's Halloween right there. Dress as your favorite book character, right? So that student's coming in as Triss from Divergent, right? Student's coming in as Katniss or PETA, all right? Those dudes Hey, Mr. Lewis, I'm wearing all black. I'm the big black dude from Hunger Games. All right, man. Did you read the book? No, but the movie was good. Maybe you gotta start somewhere, right? Okay. Hey, you know, if it's an independent reading day, it's nice outside, take them outside. Right? Go grab blankets, old blankets, take them outside. This day, I got more reading out of these kids than any other day ever, I swear. Hey, this was in fourth grade when I was teaching my fourth graders. And, you know, we were told you can't dress up for Halloween. You know, I pushed back. I don't care. So I dressed up as Batman. We had Batman Day. All right? We read nonfiction where we looked at Frank Miller and other writers and creators of the Batman comic. We read a couple of Batman comics. I had some math worksheets. You know, all Common Core grounded. But you know what? Making it fun for our kids. All right? Pep rallies, and then this is one of my favorite things, one of my favorite grade girls. You want to let students know that they care, right? That you care. This is the first time many of those girls had ever gotten a flower, right? And so, that's amazing. Take a picture, young ladies. They were so excited. That made their day. I actually teach this young lady's older brother. He was like, oh, you Mr. Lewis from school 17? Oh, you gave my sister that flower. And you kind of gave me a dirty look. I said, every girl should get flowers sometime, right? And so make them smile. And every once in a while, sometimes dance. I'm just going to show you Clickman. Can I show you Clickman in this video? Because I guess this is like the one ELA focused thing that I'm going to show. All right, so this is right off of vocabulary, all right? Check this out. Do we have sound? I do.
There's a volume in the front.
Oh man, okay, let's see. Wait.
I got it.
Oh, here we go. Could be a tiger, be strong where you met. Saying you have to wear and when. Could be modern day, the future, or way back when. Character, conflict, finish, settings. Yes, these are the five things that you're gonna be needing. Are you reading or writing a short story that's mad exciting? Character, conflict, finish, settings. Yes, these are the five things that you're gonna be needing. When you're reading or writing a short story that's mad exciting.
So I'll just stop right there. Because, by the way, it's very infectious, it's very catchy, all right? But as you can imagine, students in the sixth grade wing were singing that song all week, and I bet you they could tell you what's needed for a short story or for a personal narrative, all right? So I'll leave you with this, all right? It's easier to build strong children than to repair broken men. Why are you in the game? Thank you.
Talk about when I was making this presentation, I thought, I feel like it's so common to me that I felt like maybe you kind of already knew some of this stuff. So if you do, I apologize, and if you don't, I kind of skim over it quickly here. I have a whole other presentation with some of my students' work in another presentation when we get together later. So new literacies in the classroom, and this is a lot of text, but I'll just, in bold is the important stuff. It's multimodal. Yes, we read a book, and yes, we write an essay, and God knows we have to take those tests, but we read and write so much more. Just yesterday, 10th period on Fridays, our school does a club, and I do a digital media making movie club. And so I said, you know, how many of them were sixth grade students who I don't teach, I only teach seventh and eighth grade. And I said, how many of you consider yourself writers? And like 3 people hands went up out of 30. And I said, oh, that's funny, because I follow you all on Instagram. And I think you write there. They're like, no, we're just posting pictures and making comments. I go, well, you're writing. So, and my eighth graders did these body biographies of a book, Witness, that we read, and they were all over the room, and some of them were pretty frightening, and their eyes, these sixth graders' eyes just lit up. And I said, when you all came in, you were looking at all these posters around the room, weren't you reading it? And they stopped. I said, that is the power. If all we ever gave you was a book and an essay, and you stunk at reading a book, and you stunk at reading an essay, guess what? You never get better at reading and writing. But when you do it in many different ways, all of a sudden the things that your brain needs to do to read and to write gets better across everything you read and you write. So new literacies is all about multimodality and multiliteracies. Sociocultural and constructivist. You're going to see in a minute some of the comments the kids make. I taught also at another charter school last winter, and all we did was worksheets. All we did was worksheets, getting them ready for the test. And I thought, my God, this is not going to work. But that's what I was hired to do. You have to be active. My mantra, and I won't use that, I'm like, I know what my mantra is. I want my kids to read, write, and think critically about everything they hear, see, speak. Every single solitary thing. So much that when I was teaching in high school, I taught 11th and 12th grade at a district for 3 years, and then got downsized and was lucky enough to land at St. Amelia. So much so that the principal at one point came up to me and said, Ms. Grandits, what's your goal for English 12? I said, well, there's no test, so I wanted to read, write, and think critically. About 2 months later, she comes back, she goes, yeah, that critical thinking stuff, that's great, but not that much. Because kids who didn't get a voice suddenly were developing this voice, and that wasn't fine. Not that much critical thinking. And I thought, that's about the dumbest thing I ever heard. Whatever. Dialogic. Our classroom is set up like this. We talk deeply about topics all the time. All the time. My best teaching day is when I'm speaking for less than 5 minutes, because the kids are doing their talking. It is fun. I went on a cruise during February break. My tan is starting to peel, a little lizard-ish. And every other day this week, Monday, Wednesday, Friday, I had really bad sea legs, like so much I was grabbing onto things. I'm like, whoa, I'm really getting dizzy. And one of my kids, I said something backwards in class yesterday, and their faces kind of scrunched up, and I said, what's the matter? They said, what did you say? I said, well, I said, no, that's not what you said. And I go, oh, sorry, I got my sea legs again today. And this one boy just yells out, well, gotta stop drinking every night. Just crack up. Like, some teachers would be offended, like, I do not drink. Oh my God, how could you say? Well, so what? My God, that's funny. That's absolutely hysterical. I wasn't drinking on top of it, I just had bad sea legs. My students compose all types of texts, body biographies, found poems, drawings, movies. They write a lot of essays, short responses. Like, I love how, and we don't do modules, thankfully. I get free creative freedom at my school. But when they do these body biographies, I can share then, and I don't think I have a picture in my present for later, but the essays that they wrote as a result of that, and I can share those with you. Shocking that an eighth grader is writing about a character being a paradox and why he's a paradox. This kid's an eighth grader and he's writing like my high schoolers. What a struggle to do. And this is huge. The stance has to guide teaching and learning if we're really preparing kids for the 21st century. I tell them, I go to school at UB, so again, I'm writing essays, really long essays. But when I didn't go to college, I never wrote a 5-paragraph essay, ever. So you are not always going to be in school, so what other ways do you have to read and write? Obviously, it's engaging. the instructional environment, and we kind of talked about, I talked about this a little bit, authentic dialogue. I really want to know what they have to say. One of the best compliments I ever got was from a student who said, you know why I like your class? Because you're the teacher, but sometimes I could tell you weren't as much as we do. Because sometimes they bring up something about a piece of literature that I never considered. To some people, I guess that could be threatening. To me, they'll bring it up and I'll say, wait, tell me why you think that, because I didn't think that. Tell me. And I really, really want to know. It constantly is pushing their thinking. You have to incorporate multimodality both in your instruction and in allowing them to show you what they want. It's not enough just to write an essay, but the essay writing kind of follows. And then we, in the flavor of the Common Core, we are reading and writing tons of different ways. I kind of think of it like this layered cake or something. Like we're constant. I tell them, if you don't do the baby steps while we're reading a book, you're not going to be able to do what I need you to do at the end. But that we are reading informational texts and poetry, and we're watching a documentary and watching a TED Talk, and we're analyzing and breaking it down. Then when they go to write the essay, it's a piece of cake because their brain, and this is where I'm struggling. I don't know if it's because they're exposed to it in so many ways, like there's the subject, let's attack it, or is it because their brain is starting to think in other modes that then through transmediation is what the process is called, that they're then able to do when they go to write. And it's just remarkable. Obviously some of the pitfalls, you have to teach them how to talk because many times it's just the teacher and you're taking notes and you're spitting back what the teacher said. I just thought I'm a talkative kind of person, even though I was in long grade. I just thought people knew how to talk. And the first time I did it in my first high school class, I thought, oh God. They all stared at me like, yeah, but what's the right answer? Well, I don't know what the right answer is. So I actually had to, you have to teach them how to do it if it's not your classroom environment. It, to some administrators, can appear playful and there's no real work going on. I was accused once, and I'll show you in a minute the data results. We don't really know how you teach in there. Doesn't really look like you're teaching, because my mentor teacher, when I went to watch her class, so who is the boy on page 7 who said blah blah blah, and the kid would say Joey, and she'd throw an animal cracker at him, and I thought, I don't think this is real teaching. So obviously mine did not look like the lady I was supposed to be modeling my teaching after, so there was a bit of a discrepancy. So that can be a problem. Your assessments have to change. It can't be worksheets. It can't be. It absolutely can't. We get 700 copies a month at St. Amelia. I have used 50 for the school year. I don't give them a worksheet. I just don't do it. Plus, I do a lot of things digitally. Active and frequent reflection. They need to say, this is why I chose to show this character this way. They have to show you their thinking. And that can take some time. And fear. There's so much writing on those tests. Can we take the chance and let kids compose in other ways? I'm going to show you something in a minute that I think absolutely positively, yes, we can do it. Some of the student comments, the best learning is when we do reading passages and explain to each other what we think, not just what the teacher thinks is the right answer. And this was all, I give them an end of the year survey, and this is some of the things they felt. I felt like I was really involved in class. I had free will to do academic projects that were fun. I feel like the best thing we did was Socratic discussions and analyzing poems, like what seventh grader says she likes to analyze poems, but they loved it. When we talk aloud, it makes me see the book from different points of view and help me understand the book better. I really love literature class. You make us understand and not just tell us to do random worksheets. You help us advance our knowledge. And I love being able to make videos instead of book reports. The movie making in my classes really progressed tremendously. Impressive. That's great, but what about the test? Yeah, great, we're having a great time, everybody's having fun. And when I say this, I am not a big lover of the test, but it's a reality. My principal said, so what are we going to do to get the kids to be a 90% pass rate? To which I chuckled at him and said, well, we can ask half of them to stay home, and then I can get you a 90% pass rate. This was in the school where too much critical thinking was a bad thing. In 2011, 24 kids took the Regents exam. All of them passed it. 96% had 85 or higher. One got a perfect score. 2012, my last year teaching in high school, again, 100% pass rate. 4 out of 24 got a perfect score. 2 more missed it by 1 multiple choice question. This was after, I'll be honest, they came to me and said, we're not sure how you teach. We're going to hold off your tenure a year. And I thought, well, I'm losing my job at the end of the year, so what does it matter? And this is when too much critical thinking was a bad thing. And then she came to me and she said, I saw your Regents exam results. I said, mm-hmm. I guess an apology is in order. I said, do you think? And then I just because the kids are, all I ever said is the only people that matter are the people sitting before me, and I couldn't care what the rest of them said. Our very challenging state test recently, 2013, I taught 7th and 8th grade, so there was our pass rate compared to the district, and then last year again, a pretty big difference. And my 7th graders are kind of struggling readers. So, can we do new literacies in the classroom? Absolutely. Can you hide it among the test prep? Absolutely, positively. And in my breakout session, I have a Prezi showing tons of my student work, many of the examples I put on the NCTE application. And I think we owe it to our kids because they're not just going to read a novel the rest of their life, and they're never going to write a 5-paragraph essay working at Children's Hospital. So they need to be able to read and write in many ways. And I'm a firm, I really, really think that it's this cognitive processes when they're making sense of things in other modes that they're more familiar with, that then they're able to transfer it back to what we need them to do on the big, as I call it, the days the tents come, because I don't like to say the test words. So I'm like, when the tents come, this is what we need to do.
But what I've been told in the past from one of my placements specifically 3 years ago, you can't do inquiry with middle school students. It doesn't happen. You can't ask them an essential question. They won't get it. They'll give you one short response and they'll move forward. What I've discovered, if you take the time and design it properly, it works just as well as high school. My kids thrive on, if I ask them a question and it challenges them, they like it. You know, I have really good students this year that are very proactive and do a lot of outside work and outside reading. But they really like when I give them a question to explore on their own, and they're able to kind of look at things through the lens of their own experiences. The bottom just says similar outcomes. It's all in the framing. What I mean by that is, when I first looked at inquiry, I said, well, I can't have worksheets ever. Worksheets are the bad, they're bad. But then I figured that you kind of need them for the younger kids because they need to kind of see what's going on and they need to see their ideas develop on paper. So as far as worksheets go, I like to give them to my 7th graders because they like to see them and I like to read them too. They're more thoughtful in their writing sometimes than they are in their ability to discuss things. And I'm lucky enough to have an 80-minute block too, so we get to kind of do all kinds of things in that time period. So the focus of this presentation is really just me explaining my couple of units that I did with my 7th graders and my 10th graders, just so I can show you the difference between the two and how I kind of went about doing them. So this is really cool, by the way. So what inquiry looks like to me, first of all, it's a classroom full of students exploring an essential question. I figured out recently that inquiry is just improv for me. Like, I have a list of questions that I come up with every day when I teach a book or an essential question or whatever. And most of the time, it's on the fly, much like this presentation is. So it's kind of interesting. It's kind of zany and insane sometimes. And I leave class, especially with my 10th graders, and I wonder what just happened. What did we just talk about? I get a lot of resistance sometimes on specific topics, especially when we talk about, you know, female representations in pop culture or rap videos. Which is always kind of, I got a lot of pushback on that, but that's where it happens. That's where they start to think about other things, and I like to prod them. So all these, the questions that I structure usually have billions of different answers to them, depending on who you are, of course, but there's always an accompanying text with them and a key assessment. I have a couple of key assessments. I think I actually put a sheet in there that details some of them too. I have a unit planned for Julius Caesar in there, which is probably my least favorite thing in the world to teach, but doing it in an inquiry, with an inquiry unit makes it more fun for me and the kids. And we just wrapped it up and I'm happy with it. The projects are awesome. I got some like podcasts and stuff like that. Of course, I don't have those. I don't know how to put them in here anyway. So collaboration, this is pretty much brought up, you know, Ian was talking about having that collaboration with your students and getting to know them. I put in parentheses just the standards because several times in my career I've had people tell me, well, what is the point of inquiry? Where does it fit into, you know, the Common Core? Or where does it fit into with the large scale, where we're going with education. Cool, there's a standard for you. They collaborate. Discussions are understanding perspectives. Sometimes after discussion, I ask my kids, what did you learn? Who did you learn it from? Why? You know, why did you learn that? What did they say that struck you? This is just some research. I'm sure you guys have read enough, but James Paul Gies, I took a couple of courses, read a lot of books from him and enjoyed them. He had this book come out recently called The Anti-Education Era. Not really a huge fan of it, but this book was situated in language and learning, which kind of drives my instruction and my inclusiveness. I'm not gonna read you those quotes, you don't need that. Okay. Now here we go, this is my unit with my seventh graders. So we did, we read The Outsiders this year, which is an awesome book, and we structured it kind of differently. I asked them, what questions do you want to answer about identity? I gave them a word, identity, and you'll see later they came up with a poster board full of different words that come to mind, and we used that to make questions. So after they, after we spoke about it, these are the questions they came up with. Who am I? Who do I want to be? And how will I get there? How does pop culture influence me? That was my question. But this is, keep in mind, this is before I even mentioned we were doing The Outsiders. I just gave them that word and said, what comes to mind? Then we started doing The Outsiders, and I said, okay, well, this is going to fit into our larger conversation about identity. This is going to really hit on the questions that we are asking, and we're going to figure out how the book answers those questions. So I always start with the kids. You know, I get to know their writing and stuff about them, the who am I question, which I told them there's no answer to that question in seventh grade. You know, you start to figure it out as you go along. I mean, I don't even know who I'm going to be next year or tomorrow, and it's just how life works, and I try to explain that to them. And I often think I'm spewing philosophical stuff, but then I'm like, they look at me dumbfounded, and I realize that I think at least if they got one or two things I was saying, that makes me happy. So these are some of the things that we looked at for The Outsiders and for this inquiry-based unit. We had this, I believe, essays, poetry, Robert Frost, of course, because he's in the book. Langston Hughes, I love Langston Hughes, and I think he's, in my opinion, one of the most accessible poets for students to really get into, especially teaching a diverse school. I love Theme for English B and the one with the crystal stair that we actually looked at in class. I always show advertisements too because I show them that it's in the world, it happens, especially around the Super Bowl, best time to show advertisements. This year, dark and depressing stuff, but still, I taught tone with it. You know, I used it for tone. I said, what's the tone of this? And most of it was, you know, this is not funny or happy, and most of them usually are, and I asked them why and why they were doing that. So here's my key assessment for The Outsiders, which was a commercial analysis. Notice it has something to do with The Outsiders in a sense. I think I showed you the sheet has it, the first sheet. After this, they actually have to write me a little journal piece about how the commercial connected to the themes we've been talking about in the inquiry unit and how it connected specifically to certain lines of The Outsiders that I have chosen out from the book. So there is a graphic organizer for it. Again, I'm not so resistant to the worksheets anymore as I once was, but for seventh grade, they needed this to structure their thoughts. I encourage them to see how advertisements are meant to influence them, but I chose advertisements that were high interest out of the terrible crop that there was in the Super Bowl. And I also showed them a Nerf gun commercial because it's like what I have to do every time. I don't know why, just funny to me. I always point them towards how structure and words influence the meaning of a text in your Common Core. You know, you just talked about new literacies commercials, new literacies. It's there in the world, we should look at it. And then I have them storyboard the commercial at the end to change its message or target audience. My Long Island book just came out. So that to me was the biggest thing because my kids had so much fun storyboarding a commercial. You know, they were able to produce essentially a commercial at the end of the second mod. And in the next mod they explained to everyone, you know, what they changed and why they changed it. And that was where I really saw a lot of interest happening, and like the kids were able to see that, hey, I can do this. I know how to change the meaning of something, or I know how to write a text. And I think in seventh grade, it's kind of daunting to say, write me a commercial without anything before it. But having this model in place for them and having a commercial there for them to look at really kind of encouraged them to just do not as much work as they'd have to if they wrote them from scratch, but also encourage them to be thinkers. And now next time I do something like this, I might just tell them, make me an advertisement for whatever. And they actually did, so I don't know why I'm saying I might tell them. But that happened. So this unit went over pretty well. The Outsiders, if you're wondering where that fit into this, we read it along the way. We read excerpts and we kind of talked about how it related to the things in our inquiry. And I also gave them a couple of reading checks and stuff like that to make sure that they're actually following along with the text. But we didn't have enough copies to take home, so my kids read it in class anyway. So it was kind of nice to do it all there. Now, on the other end of the spectrum, I have my 10th grade students who are, for lack of a better, they have more attitude, I guess I could say. But we looked at Julius Caesar, but I didn't start the unit off with, I think, did I put it in there? I did. It's this page, the second page. You could look at that one. Just notice the top of that page, it says ELA 10 inquiry unit, what does it mean to have power? I didn't start off and say, Julius Caesar. You know, this is the cream of the crop. This is what we're reading right now. Because if I did that, my kids would probably look at me and go, why are we doing this? So I said, what does it mean to have power? We did the posters again. They brainstorm words in groups. We came up with these questions together. What does it mean to truly have power? And what does power look like? Now, if you've read Julius Caesar, you know you can answer these questions in the book. But it's harder to see these things unless we're looking for them, especially in like the 10th grade. So the reason I really enjoy doing this unit, and I did this student teaching, and actually Shelby helped make some of the stuff you see in here. Shelby, just raise your hand so I'm not talking to the air. The reason I like doing this is because I hated Shakespeare in high school. Actually, I hated everything in high school. I barely passed, but you know, that's why I'm who I am now. But I didn't like Shakespeare. I struggled with it and I shut it off. So when we approached this text and I said, well, how can I make this interesting? It was, let's start with you and let's use this to kind of the text to tell us a little bit about you. And how does it compare to our society and things that we do? And when you do it that way with these kids, they see it differently. They actually want to read it, which is crazy. I had a kid come in to me, I don't know, 2 weeks ago. We were on Act 3. It was when Caesar got stabbed to death, which is usually the high interest point in that book. And we just read it, and I was like kind of wondering, you know, what are they going to do after that? They probably think the book's over now. And my kid, this kid comes in, he's like, what's going to happen to Rome? I'm like, well, I don't know, I guess we'll find out. So it was actually cool because the inquiry unit got them more interested in the text, and it's something I hadn't planned on happening, but I went with it. You know, we read immediately that day instead of waiting another day because I saw that they were interested. Some of the texts in this unit were Mr. Mumsford, which is flash fiction, Theme for English Be Again by Hughes. I love Hughes, I'll use him for everything. Power by Kanye West. What I had originally on here was when you show Kanye West to kids, the Illuminati. Okay, David, the Illuminati, Mr. Cervone, what is this? Why are you showing us this? Are you part of it? Every single time. You think it's going to fade, but it doesn't. So I modeled again with them. We watched Power by Kanye West. I showed them the video. It's appropriate. There's some questionable things in it, but it's appropriate. You can show it. And we analyzed the lyrics. I put the lyrics in front of them. They broke up into groups and looked at them. I had them each look at one section of the lyrics, and then one group specifically at the chorus. And then we had a discussion. They taught each other about the video. And I pointed them in the discussion about imagery and positioning. And then I asked them what the central idea is, because this is that big word now in 10th and 11th grade. Well, now even in 8th, 7th, and 8th, that I'm starting to tell my kids, what's the central idea of the text? Well, there you go. I haven't stepped foot in anything below 7th grade. Although I did teach 6th grade summer school math somehow. No idea how that happened. But, so the central idea thing at the end, after they've already, you know, I didn't say any kind of these like flash terms for the Common Core or for their Regents exam in 11th grade. But then once they were into the text, I said, what's the central idea? But they had already figured that out long ago, so they just wrote it down. I know I was just rewording it differently. And so I gave them, I don't even remember what I put in there. So the central idea thing to me, when I first approached it, I'm like, well, how do you teach kids to really branch out? Because when I ask my kids what the central idea of something is, they say, power. Well, that's not a central idea, it's just a word, right? So how do you make it into a message? So really analyzing something they were interested in. I think Kanye West is still, he keeps himself relevant. So they were interested in it, and it really helped towards their understanding of both the central idea and how to analyze media more aptly. And we did it with Super Bowl commercials as well. So what I did after that, and that's what I put on the back of this packet, is I had students select a text on their own and analyze its meaning, how it relates to the essential question, and how it relates to J. Caesar. And basically, if you look at the sheet, it does ask them what the central idea is, but they've already, at that point, they should know it, because they've explained everything else about the text. And I've done this for 3 years, this specific, this prompt, so to speak, and it's worked every time, and I get really cool stuff. I have good examples in my breakout session, a lot of Coldplay. You get the off kid who will just Google power and take the first song that comes up. So, you know, you get those every so often. Even then, they're still analyzing a text, and then it's new literacies, and it's, you're doing a bunch of stuff at once, but they don't realize what they're that they're doing it because they're into it. It's like it's a sneaky way to teach them. Here's just some, those are some of the posters. I just want to point out that the grass behind those posters was in the room when I got there. I didn't put it there, so not my touch, but I couldn't figure out how to make them much bigger than that. But you'll see in the seventh grade, the top left, you get like a cool little picture of a girl. And, you know, little stuff that they come up with, but you get to 10th grade on the bottom and they start to get a little bit more serious, like government or greediness. One of them says big business, so I'm like, oh, we can talk about that all day. So the thought process is different for the seventh grade student, obviously, but it starts in the same place. And if you frame it the right way and you show them that what they say matters, then when you start doing these bigger questions that are really complicated questions, they're invested, and so they actually take the time to do it. And then they love the outsiders too, which also helps. But, and I think that about does it. So if you'd like to see some of my examples, that's what I offer in my breakout session. I also like to hear what you have too, so thanks.
Gamification, that term, I've been doing it a lot longer than I ever knew that term existed. So a couple of years ago, and I always look for new things, I don't like to do the same thing any other year. This is the first year that I've probably done the same thing 2 years in a row. And it was because we're kind of trying to track the data to see if this thing works. Gamification is not just an education. In fact, it's probably the slowest to get to education. It's already in most of the businesses and stores and online things that you do all the time. Okay? I saw this cartoon actually on one of the doors and I had it. I think it's an interesting cartoon and it's something that makes me reflect back to when I started teaching about 12 years ago. So I was fortunate enough out of upstate to start teaching kindergarten in Orange County when I was 22 years old. To the point where my principal had to tell me to lie to my parents and tell them that I already taught a year because she was worried they would think I was too young. I then went overseas to Baghdad for a year and a half and came back. My wife was pregnant at the time. We moved back here and I was lucky enough to be hired at JFK to teach sixth grade. So, and I've been there ever since. So by the time that I retire at 65, I'll have been teaching for 43 years, which is kind of scary. I don't know if I'll make it that long. Okay, but this cartoon, I like it because it's saying, here's the same outcome that every student has to have, but not every student has the same ability to get to that same point. And I think there is room with gamification where we can actually kind of bridge that gap a little bit. So I'll talk a little bit about that. So how do we individualize education? And we talk about differentiation a lot of times, but if you go in most classrooms, I think you're not going to see as much differentiation as they say they want you to do, okay? So in my eyes, gamification is one of the ways that I can do that. So the definition of gamification itself is using game-like mechanics, whether it's a console game, an Xbox game, a PlayStation game, a PC game, or even a board game, in non-game settings. So the classroom is a non-game setting. Having the Target Cartwheel app on your phone where you get to unlock more coupons is gamification for business. There are lots of things on your phone that you are addicted to and you don't realize it because those companies have some kind of CEO that is in charge of implementing gamification in those things. Okay. So the facts about gaming, and when I look at gaming, I think the kids that go home and sit for 3-4 hours a day playing video games. Okay. And you could probably get any different data if you look on any different websites, you'll find a different number, right? But I think all of us can agree that the average middle schooler or high schooler probably spends a lot more time than you would like them to in front of a console game or some kind of media game. So if this is 100% accurate, I don't know, whatever study that I got it from, that's what they said, that the average American, 8 to 18, plays 13.2 hours of games per week, okay? I guarantee they don't study for your course 2 hours a week, right? But that's the difference. 48% of gamers are females, and that you'll find that across the board, and no matter what study you'll see, it's usually over 40%, which I think usually you know, opens the eyes for some people. It's not just boys that you're trying to target with this. And 67% of U.S. households play video games. So the traditional classroom, when I started to look at this, this is where it started to open my eyes a little bit about how I taught when I first started. Okay, when you walk into any classroom, or when I did when I was younger, and I was not overly successful in high school. So I was a kid that when I was younger, I was in the gifted program, and I got bored with it, and I felt like I was being selected, so I told my mom, like, I don't want to be in that anymore. So they pulled me out of it, and then I started goofing off more, and then my grades dropped, right? It wasn't until I got to college where I started to really try hard, because I loved what I was doing, and then I was successful. So when you walk in any class, and many of our classes are like this, my first many years were like this, you start with 100%, and your whole goal for the quarter, for the year, is to not lose that 100. I better study so I don't lose that 100. I better get a 100. It's all fear-based. So when you really think about it that way, it's kind of ridiculous, right? When you go for a job search, if you weren't going to be a teacher, let's say you were going to the private sector, they wouldn't give you the job of a CEO and say, let's see how bad you screwed this up, and then we'll put you where you are, right? So you don't start at the top and work down. You actually start from the bottom and work up. So most of the time we have one path mastery. Most of the time it's one assignment. And if you are a kid in this room that was the motivated kid that was a self-driven learner, a lot of times you were probably told to take a book out and read while this kid that doesn't want to do anything, we have to wait for him to get caught up. Right? It happens all the time. And if I reflect back on my teaching career, it happened a lot. And it shouldn't happen that way. Okay? The gamified classroom, we start at zero. So I tell the kids when they walk in, you have a zero today, and their mouths hit the floor. And I said, well, why would you have 100? Why would you have 100 already when you haven't done anything in stay one of the class? So by doing the lessons that I have laid out for them, and there's choice, they can build up their grade. They are in control of that. So every week on my board, I have, this is how many points you need to be on pace for 100. This is how many points you need to be on pace for 65. Hey, do you know you're on pace right now for like a 20? Okay, why aren't you taking anything home? You're getting behind. So we run our classroom very different. Like I told you in the beginning, I have 21 lessons per quarter. Why 21? No real reason. It just worked out that way when I started creating it. They can choose whatever lessons they want to be working on. So if you walked in my classroom, you would see kids doing probably 8-9 different lessons at a time, just depending on what one they chose. They'll ultimately have to do all the ones to get, you know, 100, but they can jump around. They can be like, you know, doing a written response that day, and they want to do something a little more poetic, they might choose a lesson that is based out of that. So lessons are our quests, right? So if most of you may not be super familiar with some of the different console games, but a lot of times if you're playing a role-playing game like Dragon Age Inquisition, which was Game of the Year last year, that's a 200-hour gameplay game, and a lot of our kids are playing that game. When you start the character, you start with base stats, but then as you quest, you build up your character and become more powerful. So our lessons are called quests as they do them. That's the sheet that you have right there. Kids, when they come up in conference with me, whenever they finish a lesson, they actually write their name on the board. It's called the waiting room. They come up with me, we sit at a round table, we go over it right there. It's immediate feedback. Very rarely do I take papers home with a big stack like I used to and grade them and then turn them back with no feedback or 2 weeks later, you know, if it's something really big. Right then, when they're done, they sit with me at a table. We talk about it, what's good, what's bad, what you need. Maybe I send them back and say, you know what, you're missing some points here. Let's go back and do that. And then they write down how many points they earn. If it's a 100-point lesson, I consider that to be a one-day lesson. Something you can finish quickly, it's probably a center's activity. If it's a 5-day, it's probably a much bigger writing task, but it's 500 points. So there's different weight. And then they have their spelling tests and their homeworks and things like that. They also choose gamer tags, which most of them use on the PlayStation Network and Xbox Network, because I keep a top 10 board where their gamer tag is displayed, not the real name. Okay? And that changes each week. So you earn XP points or experience points by finishing the lesson. So 500 pointer, yeah, you finish that, it's going to bump you up a lot. So you have to determine, do you want to work on a bunch of little ones now, or do you want to jump around? That's really up to you. And that's from Call of Duty, and that's kind of where I got that idea from. So we also have levels that they go up. Okay, you're not passing until you get half of the course work done for the quarter. You know, you're starting at quite a low level. And that's the amount of experience points. 6,000 is just the number when I put this system together that I decided. So I usually quantify the lesson so it works out that way with their spelling tests and with their homework. And that's what they do to earn their grade. Now, the kids that hit 6,000 never stop at 6,000. Those high kids that normally you were told to take a book out when they were doing something, they keep going all the time. So once you finish all the lessons, I have extra credit opportunities where our they're more individually selected projects that they can work on that have writing involved. If you can come up with an idea for a project and pitch it to me and I agree with it, you can work on it and I'll give you points for it. You want to write, you know, a kid comes to me and says, well, I want to do this movie trailer and I want to write a script for it, okay, that's fine. You finished all your lessons, I have no problem with that. So it's the extended learning that they're choosing that normally they wouldn't have done. You would have told them to take a book out and wait for everybody else to get caught up. Okay, there's also some stuff out there where you can earn badges, where you can create badges for different achievements. I don't use that now, but when I told you that I've done gamification even before it existed, I used to have, because I knew Call of Duty was so popular, I used to have this big display board where I gave them military ranks for how many, for their grades. And then as they did these different achievements, I gave them badges. So I gave them night vision goggles if they had, you know, 5 100s on spelling tests. And it's funny because whenever I've done this all the years, and even now, it's the girls that actually just destroy the boys. And you wouldn't think that. You'd think the boys would be so, you know, it's video games. And they like it. But the girls, they dominate the boys. My top 10 leaderboard has been females probably 95% of the year. And it continues to be that way. So I am also fortunate enough, and I'm only touching on this real quick because I don't think most people have access to it. We actually do game-based learning in my class too. Years ago, 2013, I did a Kickstarter campaign to get about $5,000 of equipment to have consoles in my room. So we actually have Xboxes and PlayStations and actual console games. And that was a picture of my own classroom. We actually have 7 TVs because I also won a Nice Gate grant for the same thing. So we have double that amount. And in my 21 lessons, I usually put 3 video game lessons in there. Educational companies that go out to make educational video games, they always fall flat. There's no educational games out there that kids are like, wow, this is great, okay? So we actually use like well-respected, popular video games that fit the teen rating or below that I can use in the classroom. So if we're analyzing Hero's Journey, they might go on and play a game called Ni No Kuni, and they look at how, you know, when Nino's mother dies in the beginning, how that's his call to action, and how he goes through the threshold and he goes through the portal, and there's all these different things. So they look at how that ties to literacy as well. But funding is obviously a big issue for that. You know, our district's cutting people left and right, so I can't imagine I could ever go there in a year and say, can I get 5 Xboxes? You know, so that's not gonna happen. I had to find a way to get that stuff on my own. So some tools that you can use, some of you guys might use Edmodo. I know they have a badge system where you can get badges and achievements, that's gamification. Yeah, I don't actually use that. I've looked into it over the past couple of years, but it seems like an overwhelming endeavor. Class Dojo I used last year. Class Dojo is good for younger elementary and middle school. You get this little monster that you create, and you can keep it up on your projector, and you give them points for things. So if they participate, you can give them a point, and that's gamification. So maybe you have a reward system based in your classroom that as you give them points, you can also take away points. You're late class, you take points away. So, and it has all their monsters up on the screen. That's a real basic one that I used last year. 3D Game Lab is created by Boise State, and that is a very intensive one where you put all your lessons online. It shows them leveling up online. They turn their work into you online. And it's something I've looked into, but I just haven't got it off the ground yet. I don't know if I will. They don't show you too much until you actually pay for the subscription, and I wasn't that happy with how I could format my lessons and lay them out. So I have a subscription to it, but it's not something I've sort of, it's definitely interesting. You know, I've looked at it over the past couple of years. Classcraft is my favorite one. It's the one I'm using this year. In 2013, there was a guy from Canada that was trying to get this off the ground to create Classcraft, and he wanted $75,000. And he fell way short, so I think he got like $5,000. But I thought it was a great idea. I actually backed it. Go fast forward another year, 2014, he got public funding to do it. So now it's a free website that anybody can go on. Okay, and they choose a class, a mage, a warrior, a healer. They get to buy equipment for their guys if they earn the points. And if you do a paid subscription for your students, you can give them gold and they can buy new things. So it's complete gamification. Kids really like it. It's up on my board all the time. When a kid finishes a lesson, they walk up to the computer, they add their XP points in so they can keep track of their level and how many XP points they've earned. This is a little shout out to Gina in my classroom, who, although she is probably 60 pounds and one of the tiniest sixth graders I have, she is a beast on Classcraft. So she's been number one all year. She is now, it's the fourth week of the quarter, she has finished all 21 lessons for me in 4 weeks. So now she has 6 weeks to do her own independent projects. So it goes to show you a little bit when you give that kid the opportunity that normally you would hold back because this goofball over here doesn't want to do any work, and that's the reality. she can actually go and push herself farther and farther ahead. So class craft's cool because you can put them in teams, you can give points to teams, there's random events of the day that you can put little funny things in, like sometimes the random event of the day will be for a randomly chosen kid that it does on here to go into the bathroom and sing happy birthday to the first person that comes in. I write them, so I just make a weird thing, so it'll make them, you know, start class with a laugh, something like that. But they get pets they can train, they can buy equipment. And like I said, you wouldn't think that the girls were all about something like this, but they really do dominate the boys on this. The boys like buying their equipment and things like that, but they know who's number one, and they know it's Gina, and they're all gunning for her. She's not, you know, it's not happening. So I think the first 2 weeks in this quarter, she went home and probably did 15 lessons, 12 lessons, all on her own because she wanted to be number one. She wanted to be at the top of it. Okay. Pros and cons. It's not a perfect system by any means. The pros, I think that they're always learning. There's always something for them to do. There's no downtime, right? So when you finish a lesson, all the lessons are already copied. And I know I'm against worksheets too, but I probably run about 3,000 copies per quarter because every lesson I have to run about double the amount, and they're all back there for them. So they can go pick them whenever they want. They're very explicit with directions. If you come to the breakout session with me, or even if you don't, I have copies of like 5 lessons just so you can see how I format them. Come over and grab them just so you can see. And if you're on that email list, you know, to see everything that I do. There will be typos in there. I do make mistakes sometimes. The way that I run the classroom, there's lots of one-on-one discussion. Because you finish a lesson, we're sitting right there, we're talking about it. And you know, this is great, I like what you did here, what did you write about? It's not the stack of papers that is 2 weeks later after you've done it that you have some teacher comments on there and it doesn't mean anything to you. It's personal one-on-one. They're in control of their own learning. If you're failing my class, and there are failures, because it exposes the kids that don't want to work. That's the only reason. And I know I read something the other day, so I shouldn't say kids are lazy. Okay. If you fail my class, you are lazy because it's also online. All my lessons are online for them on a web page. They can print them out at home. So they're the ones that aren't doing the work. If you're failing my class, it's not because of your ability. Because I have some kids on that class graph thing that have been in the top 10 that are struggling learners. But they do more work. They work harder. I mean, that's real life, right? Not all of us have the natural ability to do some job that we want to. But if you work hard, you can get the same grade. You can get 100. It's not based on, you know, a math unit test that you can't. You struggle in math, it's so hard for you to get that 100. You just have to do more work to get there. The cons, lots of prep work, right? So all those lessons being done in advance. Yep, I do that over the summer, everything's in place. I run copies before the quarter starts, you know, so it's a lot of legwork beforehand. It's a big learning curve. Last year, we started the first quarter with 16 100s and 16 failures. Now there's a lot of kids in between there, I usually have about 100 kids. We ended last year with 32 100s. And 2 failures. But it takes them about 3 quarters to finally figure out, oh, I just got to take this stuff home. I just have to do the work to really start to get in the swing of it. And they're not accustomed to academic freedom. So when you have directions written out in front of them, they don't know what to do. So they come up to me, what do I have to do with this? Did you read the directions? No, that's what you have to do. I wrote them that way for a reason. And some do not follow those directions. Those are your struggling learners. But you know what? I always have a hard time because I think a lot of our classrooms cater to the lower learners, which is, I understand that, but the higher learners are just getting pushed by the wayside. They're not getting challenged. They're just sitting there waiting to get for the other kids to catch up. And this system allows everybody to push themselves. You know, you can be lazy and you cannot do lessons, but even if you're a struggling learner, you can push yourself a lot. So that is the end of mine, and over to check on your seats with them. Thank you for more. Thank you.